find reasons or to explain about why am I associated with oil and gas industry. It's so exciting. I can cite few things. Predominantly, the first factor is about we are precision bolting people. The term precision bolting immediately takes you to joint integrity. And this term joint integrity is a very, very critical requirement in the oil and gas industry. And that makes us more exciting to be associated with the oil and gas industry. The second point is about a social cause. When you are providing a leakage-free joint, that is a bolting done right. That is why we call it as a precision bolting. It provides a leakage-free joint. So it definitely causes, gives out a pollution-free environment, a clean environment, safe environment. That is one thing which we feel that we are contributory factors to the society by associating with oil and gas from the point of view of a precision bolting people. And from the business perspective, see, bolting again is not viewed as a subject in any of the mechanical engineering curriculum as of now, as welding joints are being taken into consideration because there are courses available. In bolting is just a simple subject over there, but bolting is definitely, there is an advanced research which is happening in the area of bolting and the process of bolting. So that is one where we as a ASME authorized professors available in our office, we are able to provide training to the technicians or engineers available in the customer field. So that is one area where we find a lot of business opportunity. And another point is the safety factor. See, when we talk about the safety factor, again, one is a leakage-free joint we are talking. Precision bolting also decides your maintenance cycle. If the bolting is not done properly, then you may have to end up in more maintenance. So as part of safety and as part of cost, both put together, there is a critical requirement, or it is viewed as a very critical requirement from the oil and gas industry segment. And that makes me more excited to be associated with this oil and gas industry. I was mentioning about safety earlier. See, when we talk about safety, there are a lot of procedures which are involved and which has to be practiced. Bolting has got a lot of procedures to be practiced. And safe bolting procedures, safe bolting theory and practice, all these things have a lot of implications in the end result. So that is the reason why the oil and gas industry look upon to us, and as a matter of fact, it is wedding. Both the parties would like to have each other, like they want us and we want them, and that is how it has a dwelling has happened that way, or a startup has happened that way, and it is continuing. And we being a partner to a US-based company, Hytor. They were the evolutionary people in bolting practices and bringing new generation technology in bolting. When I'm talking about the high torque values, particularly in oil and gas, where the torque values are set very high. The requirement of torque values in the bolting process is very high. So that is where a trained technician, a following up of sequences, bolting sequences, and and the scientific methods of bolting needs to be followed very precisely. So all these things makes us very enthusiastically look forward to associate with the oil and gas people. Increased participation and representation of women in the industry is visible from 2000 onwards, as I see it. But still, I would say, particularly in this core industrial segment, little orthodoxy is still there, and women are not in to be seen in the decision-making areas or in a high-end positions. But I would say after 2000 onwards, situation has changed where more women started coming into working in core sectors like oil and gas, steel, where earlier people, even as a matter of fact, I would say that, you know, women were not preferring, and there was no opportunities also developing into that area, but more women started preferring this. I would put it that way. Never it was like, you know, women should not enter like that. It was like women were not preferring it because it's definitely a tough terrain compared to the other easy going consumer goods or banking sector, where it's a you know, white collar job where, you know, you sit in an AC atmosphere, office room, cool. That way it becomes very easy for you to be and feel safe also. Here in a core industry, you may have to travel to different places, and the different modes of travel has to happen because many of the industries are located in remote places where reaching those points will be a tough one. So those things make women automatically withdraw themselves. See, it happened to me only once that I wanted to be, I'm basically from a steel industry. I started my career in a steel industry. So when I wanted to be in the business development role, I was blatantly refused. So then I fought for it, like I want to be in the role, and I love to do that. And so people were not rejecting me. But people wanted to see that how focused you are to become what you want to. So then the industry accepted me, and today you are seeing me as a woman sitting and talking from the, you know, core industry segment, taking a helm of ABS, you know. So that's possible. So both ways it has to happen. Like, women also have to open up. See, there are many fields in the core industrial segment also. Women can choose. It's not like, you know, you have to be labor-oriented. Jobs only are available over there. There are many areas like quality, design. See, financial engineering is one part, cost engineering, procurement. There are so many areas where, and today I'm seeing wherever I'm going, you know. See, for example, any oil and gas segment or steel segment, wherever I have visited, earlier I never used to see ladies, you know, wandering here and there. So when I used to walk, you know, people just used to see me like this. But today, it's not like that because many women are working over there. And I would say that it is becoming the numbers are increasing. So, but yes, when it comes to a decision-making role, still there is a reservation in that area, and it has to get open up. And for that, the women in the industry has to try themselves and reach up to that level. Nobody is stopping, but we have to knock the doors, and we have to have the perseverance to knock it again and again, and that will happen. This is a question close to my heart, and I can speak at length. When it comes to decision making, okay, involving huge financial implications, women go and deep dive and try to make the data as much vivid as possible, you know, descriptive. That is the inherent characteristic of a woman. So I feel like women should take more role into those type of decision making areas where analytical skills, whatever they have by their inherent characteristics, that has to be brought out. And the micro level working, see, women by nature are micro working people. We go into every nitty gritty of things at home, everywhere. We can't go in a superficial manner. We cannot just like that take one subject and just leave it at that. We always get into it, go deep into it, and that is one area where I feel that women can bring a change in the organization, because there are many decisions which happen in a jiffy and then finally it is not working out. People talk about SWOT analysis, people talk about very many technical quantitative analytics which will help them to make decisions, but by and large there is one thing called instinct, and that instinct women has, and that instinct is derived from out of all this data which they collect, and those are the areas where women have to occupy the seats and occupy the chairs and try to bring about changes. That one part I feel that women has to be getting into. So this facilitates decision making process to be more objective and success oriented. So sometimes hardcore industries miss out an empathetic view towards the employees. To fill this gap, women can take up the role HR head. So definitely people make the organization, and when people have to make the organization, many of the organization, if women are heading, you can see quite a difference. That's what I would say. So nurturing the culture of the organization, it's a family bonding. All these things are possible when women at the helm controls the function. So that is where I feel women bring a change in the organization. When people start working in a better way, automatically it contributes to the organization growth. So as a woman, if you are in the helm of affairs where you are able to manage people, then the whole organization gets the benefit out of it. That's how I see it, as one part of it. See, then one more thing I would say is the natural instinct of women to be far-sighted. Like at home, mother would say that if a father brings home the money, he would like to spend that money on that day because he wants to keep the whole family happy. But mother is one who looks beyond that day. So she says, today is there, but what about tomorrow? What about day after tomorrow? This is there as a natural instinct for women. This is very much required in the industry today because far-sighted planning. So that's where I was telling about data analytics, I was talking about empathy, and I was talking about far-sightedness. These are very great quality tools which are required for a leadership, and that women has by natural process. And that is what, if they are given opportunity and if they take the opportunity, they can definitely bring a difference in the organization. My organization, again, I would say, has felt that difference because we are three directors and the founder member is there. He would say, I want this, but how to do it? We look at it. And when we both look at it, we are two directors, women directors in the organization, and we look at it, in a different way. And that's how the organization has a bonding. The organization lives like a family, and that I'm proud to say here. From the general industry perspective, women are doing much more in every discipline, every functional area. But when it comes to core industry, I would say that women should increase their presence. towards value engineering, design engineering, financial engineering, cost engineering, business development, market research, research and development. In all these areas, there's a lot of scope, and one has to climb up the ladder by putting their efforts. And that day has to be seen. That's what. And there's a lot of scope. That's what I believe from my point of view. And by this way, they can contribute to both the bottom line as well as top line of the organization, and towards the sustained business of the organization, any industry, wherever they represent, particularly in the core segment, and which is oil and gas is one of such core segments. Yeah, I agree to it, but beg to differ also. See, it's definitely an additional responsibility. One cannot deny it. But I see it as a dual responsibility, which a woman can handle, because by nature, women are multitasking. So, when it comes to a family and your career or an official capacity, planning, managing is very important. One of the very important factor is that, you know, support system. One has to manage the support system in such a way that, according to me, if you are able to manage the support system well through your, you know, people in the family, people in the peer circle, people in the friend circle, or maybe your superiors and subordinates, wherever, whatever method you are able to form, you have to form a pattern in which you are able to have a source where you can fall back on any of your requirements. And if that is taken care, I don't think it's a big challenge for people. People struggle because the support systems are not in place. How much ever you plan, the contingencies will always be there, because it is something which is unpredictable. Today my daughter is not keeping well when she got up. It's not an expected one, because yesterday night she went to bed very nicely, but today morning she's not keeping well is an unexpected thing. Then everything gets into a doldrum in that particular day. But how do you manage it? So if you have a support system, then things will be very normal rather than catastrophic. And if this type of thing repeats again and again, then it becomes a challenge for people. But you cannot control the repeatability, because it's not in your hand. So suddenly you may have to be reaching out to the school, or you may have to, elderly parent will be there at home and you have to attend to them. So if this support system is in place, then of course you can, okay, somebody is there to take care and I can put my mind over here. Or if this is so, then priorities can be set, which one is more important. So based on that, you take a lead ahead. Those things possible only when you have a support system in place. So that's how I feel that one, if one has to be career oriented, being a woman, she has to first find a support system in the family. And if children has to be taken care, then family people should be readily agreeing to your career path. Then there's no look back onto that. Or your peers and your friends, if you're in a nuclear family, there should be some supports where you are mutually agreeing to each other's demand, like, you know, then it becomes very easily settleable. So that's the way I see it. See, today's business is all about brand value and brand recall. Without brand value, creating a brand value and a brand recall, you cannot be giving your presence with sustainability. If you want a sustained presence and your market share intact, then creating a brand value and maintaining the brand image and also creating a brand recall is very important. See, we at ABS for the past two decades have been relentlessly working for it. I'll just take a little deviation here to explain, like, you know, in an FMCG or in a consumer-oriented industry, there are very many ways people see it about the brand recall or the brand value setting and things like. Very many scientific process has been adopted. It's a big area where so much research is going on, and new evolutions keep on coming to find the ways to retain. But from the core industry point of view, particularly oil and gas industry, or again I talk about mining or steel or anything, and with reference to oil and gas because your question is about oil and gas. See, the brand value or the brand recall will happen only through the quality initiatives in the process and the sustainability which we adhere to in the quality systems and process. So that is where I am happy, and I would like to boast of here to say that we at ABS, we have maintained this sustainability for the past two decades, relentlessly working with systems and process management. And in the size of our company, like, you know, mid-size organization, when ISO 9001 2008 became 2015, we were the first to approach TUV to get it recognized for ISO 2015. So such is the case where we have started working towards taking it serious, the quality parameters, right from top level where we are sitting to the bottommost layer. That's what I say, the from the director to the gateman, everyone in your organization should be in line with the thought process, and the quality consciousness should percolate down. So I would recall one of the incidences where, you know, we got an opportunity to work with Chevron for their project in Bangladesh. It's a greenfield project in Bibiana. It's called Bibiana Oil and Gas Project. So when we got qualified through tender, and I had to go for the first call meeting. So it was all like very nightmarish for me. Like, you know, they were talking, they were even breathing quality, they were even breathing safety. So it was like too a high standard for our level of industry to catch that point. But then I took it as a very, you know, important milestone in our life that we have to get into that boat. So then we worked lot of iterations. 3 months I was writing only the quality systems and procedures, sitting in the same very cabin, you know. I could recall that. It's very nostalgic to think at this point in time. But yes, lot of, I'll be sending my process, then it will come back saying that I have to get group 4, grade 4 to pass out. I won't get more than 3. I won't leave it also. Again. But then we got it. So if you can see back, there is a, you know, safety award. And we got the best safety award after, I mean, while we finished the project, we came out with the all applauds and appreciations from Foster Wheeler and Chevron. This is possible only by maintaining the quality factors. Now, ABS is a brand which is known to people like Reliance, people like IOCL, people like BPCL, people like British Gas, people like Kane, Chevron, anybody, wherever the bolting process has to be done, or there is a requirement of, you know, bolting process, then ABS name is automatically attached over there. So that is called brand recall, and that brand recall in core industry will come through your continuity or sustainability of your quality standards, which we always keep in our mind. And once we achieve one set of standards, then we look upon for our next milestone as to what is happening currently in the industry and what is the new standard set by the industry, and we have to march towards that. As long as that coach, that search is there, I think there will be growth, but the saturation will come once we think that we have done everything. So I don't want to get in that mode. So branding, again coming back to branding, the brand recall plays a very important role for your sustainability and growth. So branding is very important, and that can happen only through the quality initiatives or the standards which you set for yourself. When you come to online branding, see, today is the day of Amazon and Flipkart, and everybody wants to go online and do their part of it. If your online presence is not there, how much of a good you are, how much of a qualitative work you do, you can't be so loud to people and reach out to every nook and corner taken the spread of the country. So that is possible through online platform. So you just put your keywords and people search for those keywords, and people get to know of your company. So it is like a swipe card, entry point, where you get an entry. After your entry is done, then you have to work to sustain. But how does that entry happen? How does that reach happen? That reach can happen only through the online platforms. And today we are so blessed that the online platform does a fantastic job in taking us to the nook and corner of the country, where we feel, we used to feel that a large amount of people is required to cater to that. So the market presence, putting ourselves into the market right in front of the people, or just opposite to their chair, sitting like a supplier sitting in front of them, that job is being done by the online platform. So just they Google it to find out where ABS is. So that's a fantastic job. So to precisely say, from 4 Newton meter to 180,000 Newton meter, we cater to all the bolting needs, and any type of an industry, whether it is an automotive industry or a hydro industry, hydropower, which has got the largest holes. So as ABS, we are a one-stop shop for every bolting needs, and to do it with precision. To come into the area of my leadership role, I would like to share some of my few experiences, how my journey was. And I started my career, I'm not a technical engineering graduate, by the way. I did my economics and then continued with financial management, and also did my master's in administration, business administration. But I was so scared of science. I was not even thinking that I'm going to work in a completely science-oriented subject all through my life. During science classes, I used to skip when I was in school. But this is so interesting. So when I joined the steel segment, metallurgy came so close to me, and I started learning from my seniors, and that was on field education which put me into understanding of the technical nuances. See, one of the most important thing which I have learned in life is logical reasoning, which is very important for any of the job you'll be performing. And one more important thing is the process orientation. When you are able to understand the process orientation, when you are able to understand that time management, which is very important for taking up any task, and if time is not taken into consideration, then nothing will move ahead in business or even in life. So these are the basic concepts which has made me go up in my ladder when I started adhering to these things. And there were many people, I should say, my mentors who were so responsible for making me what I am today. I would say it's an university where I had gone through, whether it is metallurgical gurus or the mechanical engineers whom I had been working with, and I had understood what is required and necessity for running my business. And with that logic put in, and I'm able to be, and see, the one aspect is that being a financial management person by education, so I'm able to take care of the finance side of my company. And business administration, of course, I did it in human resource, so I'm able to take care of those areas as well. Logistics and the materials management is again a part of the business administration, so that also came handy. See, more than anything is the interest to do things, like take up task, whether you know it or not, try it and you will learn it. The will to do is very important, and you do mistakes, you learn. You shy from mistake, you will never learn. So that is one thing, which is if someone comes in, when I was even at 30 or at my young age of getting exposed to the employment, people used to come and tell me some odd jobs, because that time only this computerization was coming up, and people used to tell me to do some programs and this and that, analytical things required for doing the programming. But I've never shied away from anything. So whatever was given to me, I started taking it. Today, be it a production, be it a production process, making up a Gantt chart or preparing a Gantt chart for executing a process, executing a project, it all becomes a very easy task for me, because I took interest into it and started learning it and started doing it myself. One has to be hands-on, one has to be micro. If you are hands-on, if you don't delegate everything and delegate only what is to be delegated, then you will learn things. If you don't do it yourself, you'll never learn it. So that's a mantra I carry, and hope I'm successful. And I look forward to being and to do a lot of things more ahead in my life. Every day should be challenging. It should be dynamic. New challenges has to come, and we have to face those challenges. Without challenge, there's no growth. So if there is no challenge for quite some time, that makes me jittery, because life is not moving ahead. So once you start getting challenges, then that means there is some growth path which is there in front of you. That's the way I take it.